Psalm 124, Introduction and Verse 1 has its eye on the past. We have been following the pilgrims from their Bedouin city on their pilgrimage to Jerusalem in these previous three psalms. Psalm 124 is written in the same style as the theme of Psalm 123 that was written as the eye of hope and look toward the future, so Psalm 124 has its eye on the past, reviewing the history of God's mercy and His deliverance of Israel in their past. The song carries the title A Song of Degrees of David. Though some scholars challenge David's authorship, we can at least be confident that the style is very much Davidic and with the same prose as do the other unchallenged psalms, setting forth the assistance and deliverance of Jehovah in the midst of great dangers. The eight verses of this psalm break out in this fashion. Verses 1 through 5 direct our reflective thoughts to the previous blessings and special deliverance of the Lord, representing times of great troubles and springing Israel out of the hostilities of humanity. And then verses 6 through 7 share the intervention of God in working out His plan for His special possession, and finally verse 8 yields a statement of confidence in our Lord for all future generations in times of trials. May we be rescued from future demonic assaults by the power of our holy reliance upon our intercessor, the mediator Jesus Christ. The whole premise of the psalm is to build our faith and trust as we encounter times of danger, and that our deliverance must be ascribed wholly to God, offering praise and worship to Him alone. Martin Luther wrote, "Every prayer is long enough if it be fervent, and proceeds from a heart that understandeth the necessity of the saints." Psalm 124:1 is a statement with what will follow in the next five verses, "Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say. He who previously lifted his eyes unto the hills has now in confidence raised his eyes to the Lord himself." He believed in a personal God and knew nothing of our modern-day pantheism, which amounts to nothing more than atheism wearing a fig leaf, where all that we consider gods are all the same. While it is correct to say that our one true God is evermore the same, therefore will I look to Him. Even though the God that we worship rises above all others perceived as God, and our God is unchanging, sadly natural-born human nature will not relinquish its self-assumed authority. Even among Christians, many have a bad habit of not looking up first, or they may have prayed half-heartedly without expectation, and in unbelief. Among the unredeemed, when their dilemmas are so overwhelming that the natural-born man can no longer bear it, only then in a final plea of frustration will it yield to God for mercy. And by the way, prayer need not be long. If this psalm is an example, as you can see in the eight verses of this psalm, it is noticeably short, and therefore a fit illustration for demonstrating the power and force of prayer. It need not consist of many words. Rather, it is the fervency of our spirit that truly counts and sets forth something like the unsophisticated cry of a child in distress. If we desire God to turn His eyes from our sin, then we must turn our eyes toward Him seeking His mercy and compassion. Our prayer becomes the testimony of a believing, obedient, and thankful humble heart. When we have repented, we can be bold enough to lift our eyes toward heaven and look upon the one that we cannot see, rather than look toward the ground in formidable shame, knowing that we have been forgiven by our faith in the evidence of things not seen. We read in Hebrews 11:1, "Now faith is the reality of what is hoped for, the proof of what is not seen." The psalmist now recounts the modus operandi, the disambiguation that had stunted his faith in Israel's provider and protector. Breakfast Bible Bites.